Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your
spirit. On the day of her baptism, Jonas Yanni was welcomed into the church, giving new life in Christ, and clothed with the garment of salvation. Today we greet the body of our sister and surround her with the church's prayer. We commend our sister to the mercy of God and pray that the promise made to her in baptism will be fulfilled.
Let us now begin our entrance song.
Yeah. Let us pray. O God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant Onesimus, whom you have called to journey to you, and since she hoped and believed in you, grant that she may be led to our true homeland, to delight in his everlasting joy. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thank you. First letter of St. John, chapter 3, verses 14 to 16. We have passed out of death and into life, and of this we can be sure, because we love our brothers. If you refuse to love, you must remain dead. To hate your brother is to be a murderer, and murderers, as you know, do not have eternal life in them. This has taught us love, that he gave up his life for us, and we too ought to give up our lives for our brothers. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sincerest condolences
to the family of our sister. On behalf of Father Easy, Father Charles Martin, and myself, we offer you our sincerest sympathies and our prayerful support. When we gather for any funeral, it is both a moment to pray and a moment to think. A moment to pray, and in prayer there is both thanksgiving, there is contrition, there is praise, there is honor given to God specifically for the life of our sister and the blessings of that life that God, only God, could have given. We thank God for a life of over 90 years old. A life filled with faith, with hope, and with love. And we pray that God, in His goodness, would truly welcome our sister into His presence. We also gather as a Christian community to pray for the family who are experiencing the loss of their loved one, the loss of our sister, those who knew her more intimately, those who experienced her, those whose memories are so vivid. We pray for them as St. Paul instructs us to weep with those who weep and to rejoice with those who rejoice. But as we gather for any funeral, and in fact every funeral, we who come together as Christians, as family and as friends, we are invited to pray for ourselves and to think about our lives. Yes. To pray for ourselves and to think about our lives. To pray that we would be strengthened through this gathering, through this saying goodbye. That our faith in the resurrection and new life given by God undeservedly, that we too would obtain that we would enjoy that when our own time comes. And to think about the direction and the purpose of our own personal and individual lives. To think about the strength of our faith. To think about the perseverance of our hope, to think about the endurance of our love. This is why we come together. Job offers us some food for thought in that direction. When he says, "Ah, that my words were written down and inscribed on some monument with iron chisel and engraving tool, cut into the rock forever." And this is what he wants written down. "This I know, that my Redeemer lives, and he, the last, will take his stand on me. This I know, that my Redeemer lives." If there's one thing I can say with great certainty, is that our sister knew her Redeemer. She knew him intimately. I mean, I cannot not remember a time that I didn't know this lady in church prayer. Member of so many different sodalities, praying constantly, without ceasing. It's like her life was consumed in prayer. You know, during the Christmas season, we read read about the presentation of Jesus in the temple and talks about Simeon and Anna. And Anna, a woman who is now 84 years old, never left the temple night and day praying and fasting. That's the image that comes to mind when I remember our sister. The image that comes to mind as well is the image of the Sacred Heart that I have there on my left. An image that speaks of the faith and the certainty of faith that I know that my Redeemer lives. We may have members of the Sacred Heart Society here with us to my right. A group that is waiting because for various reasons some people are not inclined to become part anymore of such solidarities. But nevertheless, an important reminder of the need for prayer and the need for faith in our lives. When you look at the image of the Sacred Heart, it is the image, yes, of a heart on fire, a heart crowned with thorns. And she believed in the Sacred Heart of Jesus to save her, to grant her eternal life. The image of the Sacred Heart is one that puts forth and shows forth great, great love, great, great passion, and great, great suffering. When we think of the heart, we think of that place that is the seat of love. I tell people February 14th is not the feast of love of the church, but it is the feast of the Sacred Heart that is the church's Valentine's Day. Because that is the feast that we celebrate the great love of God that saves us. The love of God that gave us His Son, Jesus Christ, who in His own self gave His own life on the cross that we might live. St. John says that there is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. Donna Smith had faith in that love of God, in the Sacred Heart of Jesus. She knew that love saves, that love is life, and without love there's death. Without love, life becomes monotonous, repetitive, and in fact, not worth living. So the Sacred Heart today stands before us as a sign that we are invited to open our own hearts towards the Lord, to break them open from the pride that sometimes closes them, the anger that sometimes closes them, the unforgiveness that sometimes closes them, to open our hearts, to break them open, and to allow that total, sacrificial, suffering love to enter into our own hearts and to transform them. That is the message that this woman, whom we have come to bury today, I think would like to leave us with. The message of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. You see, wherever there is true love, there's always sacrifice and suffering. It is only the false love of the world that seeks its own pleasure. And a lot of people confuse lust with love. A lot of us who think that we are in love with others is simply our own self-gratification factor. But until you suffer for another person, you don't know what love is. Until you sacrifice your own time, talent, and treasure, your own being for another, you don't know what true love is. Unless you can take food out of your own plate and give to another person and deny yourself, you don't know what true love is. The Sacred Heart of Jesus stands for that true, lasting love. That we are invited to make part and parcel of our own lives, starting now. Because this is the moment to think about our faith and our love. To think about who we place our faith in and who it is that we say that we really love. In fact, Jesus says to us that if you have faith enough to make the greatest commandments part of your life, then you have everything, as the letter of John says to us today. For the thing of the love that the Father has lavished on us by letting us be called God's children, and that is what we are, God's children. And if we refuse to allow genuine love to enter into our hearts and to be witness to in our lives, then we die. But if that love, that true love, that love of Christ comes into our hearts and we can love God and love our neighbor, then we have eternal life. And that's what the gospel today is all about. If you listen to these words just proclaim, these words are sacred scripture, if you listen to them and if you believe them, as our sister did, eternal life is yours. Of course, as one person reminded me, there's no such thing as perfect this side of heaven. And so our love will always be in this world imperfect. But what is important is that we strive to love. We strive with all our energy, as Jesus asked, with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our souls, with all our strength, that we strive towards the perfection of love in our lives. And that will save us. That will bring us eternal life. That will heal our rifts and our rivalries and our competition. That will heal our society and heal our families. That kind of love will heal our church. That kind of love. But we are invited to listen and to believe. Listen and believe. The last part of this short reflection on the words of sacred scripture of today, I just want to remind you of the last lines of this gospel. A lot of people, when they think about evil, tend to think about the little creatures with horns and maybe a tail. But you know, the true evil in the world is the lack of love. That is the true evil in the world. Yesterday I was saying during the homily on Sunday, you know what is the greatest hypocrisy of all among us, as Christians and as people? The biggest hypocrisy comes from the letter of John that says, how can you say you love God and you hate your brother or sister?
True.
That is the greatest hypocrisy that we as human beings and as Christians commit sometimes on a daily basis. A lot of to credit God with their success, with their fame, with their fortune, with their hard work. But when it comes to loving God, reading and making time for God, your father, yes. When it comes to true prayer and building family and forgiving, your father. But with their mouths, oh God. So as we think about our lives once more, as we pray today in this Mass, let us ask God for the strength to turn once more to look at this image of the Sacred Heart, to look at it steadily, focus on it, and say, Lord, may my heart be like your own heart. May my heart be as sacred as your heart, Lord. May my heart bleed for you and for my loved ones and for my neighbors and for my friends and for my community. May my heart radiate. May my heart be on fire for you and for my brothers and sisters. And then we will be on our way to follow Jesus into eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand and pray. Sisters and brothers, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to him.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those of us who are at the crossroads.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Duncan. We beseech your mercy that she who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find him a merciful judge, who lives and reigns forever and ever. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, and those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended, and when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, pour out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, the spouse, with the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Peter and Paul, with John the Baptist, Mary Magdalene, Joachim and Anne, Martin de Porres, Josephine Baptista, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the salvation and peace of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Gabriel, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained before your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Donatien, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. When from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Teach us how to call on the Father. And Jesus indeed says, when you pray, say, Our Father, reminding us that we have a Father who waits for us to return to Him, who is eager to embrace us. So with these thoughts in mind, let us lift our minds and our hearts and pray with all sincerity the prayer that Jesus Himself taught us. As we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son has blessed the sacrament of this body, who will for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it, our sister Donna Sin may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Let us pray with confidence to God who gives life to all things, that he will raise up this mortal body to the perfection and the company of his saints. Jonathan, may God give you the visible judgment and forgive all those sins. May Christ, the Good Shepherd, lead you safely home to be at peace with God our Father. And may he be happy forever with all the saints in the presence of the eternal King.
Donatien, may the angels with you in the paradise
May the martyrs come to welcome you at your bay and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee.
This was the funeral mass for Donna St. George. This YouTube Live was brought to you by EmoNews. Stay tuned, we'll be back shortly on YouTube with the burial. Once again, stay tuned. We will be back shortly at the burial ground. Thanks for viewing. Yeah.